Sempre Fides, pes, caritas, triviae. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Your Excellency, Reverend Father Rector, Reverend Fathers, dear seminarians, dear brothers, dear sisters, dear faithful. 4 weeks ago, if you remember, we had in the Gospel, it was on the fourth Sunday after Epiphany, this question of the apostles in the boat just after the storm: who is this man? Who is this man whom the winds and the sea obey? And indeed, we can understand their astonishment after this miracle. How is that possible that this man, a man like any other man, who was sleeping just a few minutes before, manifesting in an obvious way his weakness, his human nature, how is that possible that this man has the power to command the winds and the sea? And human reason cannot answer this question. Here, the apostles were facing the mystery of our Lord himself, the mystery of the incarnation, our Lord, true God and true man. And so, a mystery which has no human explanation. Our Lord will say to St. Peter, "Blessed art thou, because flesh and blood has not revealed it to thee, but my Father who is in heaven." So it's only by a grace, a supernatural grace, that we can believe. Because we cannot understand this mystery, which are essentially supernatural. And so we need a special grace sent by God, a grace from above. And because of this grace, the apostles were able to make this act of faith in something that they couldn't understand, the mystery of the divinity of our Lord. But nevertheless, our Lord gave to the apostles signs of his divinity. And these signs were his miracles, the miracles he performed to make the apostles able to make this act of faith. So it was exterior, visible, obvious, easy to understand signs, so that it became to us reasonable to make this act of faith. And even it was obvious that it would be unreasonable not to believe in our Lord's divinity. And then through these signs, they were able to make this act of faith in something that they couldn't understand, but they accepted, to submit themselves to the authority of our Lord, to our Lord's teaching, but not without a grace, a special grace of faith, which came from God. But today, they are facing another mystery, and a greater one. Today, they hear our Lord, whom they know to be God, Almighty God, creator of heaven and earth, and they hear him saying, explaining that he has to go up to Jerusalem. And he wants to go up to Jerusalem, because there he will be delivered to the Gentiles, be mocked, be scourged, and spit upon, and that after being scourged, he will be put to death. And for that, he wants to go up to Jerusalem. And St. Luke, we heard it in the Gospel, concludes simply saying, they understood none of the things. They understood not the things that were said. Here they are facing another mystery, because our Lord didn't come on earth to reveal only his own mystery, but more than that, he came on earth to reveal the mystery, the very mystery of God, the very nature of God. This mystery, as says St. Paul, which has been hidden from ages and generations, but which is now manifested to his saints. And that is the mystery of God's charity, the very nature of God, the very mystery of God's life, the infinite charity of God. And so here too, because our Lord knows our human nature, our Lord is going to give us, or to give to the apostles and to us also, a sign to make us able to see that to believe in this mystery is reasonable, and that not to believe in it is unreasonable. And this sign is a sign of the cross, the foolishness of the cross. The cross is a sign chosen by God to make manifest his mystery of his infinite charity. And because this sign is meant to make us know this mystery, as St. Paul says, which is which surpasses all knowledge. And then this sign is, for human eyes, a foolishness. But it is a sign. And so it is an obvious, visible, exterior, an historical event that we can see. And so which can make us able to know this mystery. It will not explain it, but it will make us manifest this mystery. And the apostles saw our Lord coming to Jerusalem. They saw our Lord going himself to his passion, delivering himself to the soldiers. And at least St. John saw our Lord dying on the cross in a really visible way. And then St. John was able to say, "En nos credidimus caritati." And we have known and we have believed the charity which God hath to us. And we can read in the Gospel of St. John, right after the crucifixion and our Lord's death, "And he that saw it hath given testimony, and his testimony is true. And he knoweth that he saith true, so that we also may believe." So, who is this man? Was the question of the apostles after the storm. But now, when our Lord is announcing his passion, our question must be, who is this God? This God made obedient to death and the death of the cross. And certainly such is the intention of the Church when she asks us every year to meditate upon our Lord's passion and death for 40 days during Lent. The Church wants us to look at the sign of the cross so that we may be led to make this act of faith in this mystery of the infinite charity of God that we cannot understand. But by this sign, we can make this act of faith, and we can submit ourselves totally to God. We can give ourselves totally to God because we can believe. And we know because of this sign that it is reasonable to give ourselves totally to God, and even that it would be unreasonable not to give ourselves totally to God because of this sign. St. Thomas says it when he explains why our Lord suffered this passion. He gives as first answer. "In the first place," he says, "man knows thereby how much God loves him, and man is thereby stirred to love him in return, and here lies the perfection of human salvation." So such is the first purpose of Lent. To look at this sign, to contemplate the sign of the cross, so that we may be led to make this act of faith in this incomprehensible mystery of God's charity. But that's not all, because if the sign, the foolishness of the cross, is a sign, a visible, exterior, obvious sign, by which we can see that it is reasonable to give us totally to God, it is only a sign. And therefore, it doesn't explain the mystery. The mystery of our Lord, of God's charity is not perfectly explained in the sign of the cross. It's only a sign. But the mystery is beyond all knowledge and beyond all manifestation. And therefore, this mystery requires an act of the supernatural virtue of faith, and therefore a grace from God. We cannot believe in this mystery without a special grace from God. Like the apostles needed a grace from God to believe in our Lord's divinity, even if they had enough by the miracles performed by our Lord to believe, or to know that it was reasonable to believe. But they needed a grace, a special grace from God. How many people saw the miracles of our Lord. How many people saw our Lord on the cross, dying on the cross, but they didn't believe, not all of them. And here is the same. To believe in the mystery of God's charity, we need a grace. And we have to ask God for this grace. And that's the second purpose of Lent. So that by our insistence, by our perseverance in prayer, in penance, by our sacrifices, we may obtain from God this grace. So may God give us, grant us a bit of this faith that St. Paul, that St. John had. May God give us this grace that we need to believe in his charity so that we may say with St. John, with St. Paul, I live in the faith of the Son of God who loved me and delivered himself for me. In the name of the Father, to the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Yeah. Thank you. Je ne dis que de l'éducateur.